from the nation's capital, this is the Fly Fishing Consultant Podcast with your host, Rob Snowett.
Rob Snow White. This is my fly fishing educational podcast. This is episode 208, Fly Fishing Cape Cod 101, specifically for striped bass, with Anthony Lombardo of the Bear's Den Fly Shop. And I want to thank you because if you're listening, you went out of your way to download this podcast. You wouldn't be here if you weren't interested in the stories and the information that I'm bringing to you. We are going to give a big thanks to the Bear's Den Fly Shop, bearsden.com. In this podcast with Anthony, we're going to talk about the location and history of Cape Cod, the fishing and packing list, the seasonality of the bait fish that you will find there to match the hatch, some local patterns, and we will discuss some miscellaneous things one might need to know when it traveling to Cape Cod. Enjoy this one because it helped me prepare for Cape Cod, and I learned a lot of really cool new information, and I hope a lot of it is new to you too. This is going to be a cool one. All right, Anthony, you want to introduce yourself?
Yeah, my name is Anthony Lombardo. I'm working at the Bear's Den Fly Shop in Taunton, Massachusetts, probably for the last 3 or 4 years anyway. I've been doing their free Wednesday night fly fishing group for the last 2 years, basically a free guided trip around the Cape, open to anybody on Wednesday nights while the striped bass are here.
Really? I might take you up on that next week.
Yeah, no problem. As long as the weather is good, we'll be out there. And
I'm hoping we'll lose power while we're doing this. We had up to 11 inches of rain locally over 2 days, and now we're getting 5 to 6 in the next 2 days. So the trees are falling everywhere.
Yeah, so. Doesn't sound like fun. I mean, up here we haven't had any severe weather lately, but it's been hot. So fishing's been kind of slow during the day, but nighttime, early morning, dawn, it's been great.
All right, we'll get into that. So you're a local up there, I take it?
I grew up in Rhode Island, moved to Massachusetts about 10 years ago. Yeah, been fishing the Cape ever since. I started out actually guiding for trout in the western part of the state where we have a few tailwaters. I just really fell in love with fly fishing and got into the industry. And once I, started hooking striped bass on a regular basis, I can't really think about much else.
Oh, man, I'm looking forward to next week. I don't expect to catch anything, but all of this is going to help me and others that get there. All right, so you are at Bear's Den, and if I'm driving towards Cape Cod, how far is that shop off the road?
It's about 5 minutes off the road. And if you're coming from the north or basically anywhere except taking 195, you're going to go right by it. So we're right off 495, exit 9. And, it's about 5 minutes from the highway. So you're going to pass us.
Very cool. I'll see you on Saturday. Let's see. So where exactly is Cape Cod located?
The southeastern part of the state. It's separated from the mainland by the Cape Cod Canal, which is basically a 7-mile man-made trench that they dug during the early 1900s. They talked about making it during the 1800s, but didn't really get underway. I think it was 1909. It took about 7 or 8 years to dig. It's about 480 feet wide, 7 miles long. And what it does is it turns a 135-mile voyage around the Cape to a 7-mile voyage.
Wow.
Through
the canal of Panama. So they didn't have to go around.
Yeah, pretty much.
So I was not even familiar there was a canal there until I started researching Cape Cod fishing on Instagram. I had never heard of the canal.
The canal's pretty much a mecca of striped bass surf fishing. From what I hear, Montauk and that area's kind of slowed down a little bit the last couple of years. The canal's really picked up. It's not an easy place to fish. Fly fishing-wise, is really only a couple spots where you can get deep enough with a fly and be able to wade out into the water. the car moves pretty quick. It's about 6 miles an hour, almost all the time. And it is 480 feet wide. The fish kind of tend to stay either way out in the middle or down almost 20, 30 feet. So you can do it with the fly rod. Guys can, you know, they use two hand rods and, you know, T11, T20, you know, big, huge sink tips. Some guys even will chuck and duck a, you know, like a regular conventional lure on the end of a running line with a leader just so they can fight the fish on the fly rod. But it is a mecca of striped bass fishing. Regularly 30 to 50 pounders are pulled out of there.
Does it stack up with boats? Like, no, I imagine kayakers.
No, kayaking is, from what I understand, is not allowed. You cannot fish in the canal. It's run by the Army Corps of Engineers. They kind of maintain it and regulate everything. So really, it's just it's used for what it was intended to. Just a, you know, just a through port for, yeah, for big ships. You'll see cruise ships through there. Huge tanker ships go through there. But it is lined with a bike path on either side. It's rocks. They can be steep. But, you know, guys will pile on the rocks on either side of the canal. And when the fishing's good for 7 miles, it can be almost shoulder to shoulder.
Wow.
It's pretty amazing.
That's fascinating. And maybe I've read about that in an article and skipped over it, but I had no recollections. That's fascinating. Maybe we'll take a stop there just to look at it.
Yeah, it's worth a stop just to look for sure.
Interesting. All right. And how far east? The Cape is going to be much further east where I am in Northern Virginia. So I imagine sunrise earlier, sunset earlier. We were just out in Columbus, Ohio, and it didn't get dark 10 o'clock at night because we were further west. I'm going further east. Do I have to expect the opposite?
Yeah, I'd say so. I'd say sunset right now is going to be right around 8:30 around there, I believe. I'm not really sure. I don't have a calendar in front of me. But, yeah, sunrise is I mean, you can get some daybreak. I'm starting to peek through right around 4 o'clock in the morning right now. So, I mean, that's probably prime time to get out there. I'd say go an hour before the actual posted sunrise, and you'll have some twilight, and you'll be able to fish.
How many days do you get out there a week?
Some weeks, 5 to 6. On average, probably about 4.
Oh, that's fantastic. Good for you. And what makes the fishing so special on Cape Cod? Is it just the position out on the Atlantic? I've always known it's this famous striper location.
I think it's got more to do with all the inlets and bays and estuaries we have. It's the whole Cape is littered with them, from, you know, the south side all the way around, up the north side, all the way to Provincetown. You can find inlets and estuaries every couple miles. And what those are going to do is they're going to hold a ton of bait fish and even some holdover stripers. And it just gets water flowing. You know, they come in to chase the bait fish. And as long as you can, you know, get access to any of the inlets or an outlet, and, you know, you can fish those. You can swing flies in there. You're going to have, you know, left to right current or right to left current.
That's how we have it around here in D.C. On the Virginia side, there are tidal creeks, and it's fairly hard banks on either side, and you just get out there with a sink tip and cast across and just swing a clouser through there, and they'll crush it.
Yeah, that's pretty much you can find that all over Cape Cod. And the one good thing about Massachusetts is there's an old law. I think it's more of a navigation law than anything else, but nobody owns the beach. So as long as you're fishing below the high water mark, which is usually really high up on the beach, you can walk wherever, in front of somebody's house, behind somebody's house. As long as you can get access to the water, you can go right up and down the beach.
Awesome. I read in, I think it was Fly Fisherman or American Angler, it was a Muskie article, and they were saying this weekend is going to be the Snake Moon or something. I don't know if that's the name of it. Anything special with the full moon coming this week? More higher tides?
Moons? Yeah, moons can play a huge role here. I love the new moon, to be honest with you, but the full moon is definitely comes a close second. And what's going to happen is you're going to have a lot more water movement, and water movement moves the bait fish around, and it's going to move the big fish around as well. Something unique to the Cape. I mean, there's a couple spots in the south side of the Cape where up in the bays and the estuaries, you're only going to have like a 2 to 3 foot tide swing from high to low. On the north side of the Cape, there's a couple creeks where during a regular moon cycle, you're going to have a 7 to 8 foot, you know, tide swing. You get a new moon in there, that 7 or 8 foot is going to jump up to almost a 13 foot tide swing.
Wow.
So you have the same, you know, same volume of water in the estuary, and it almost doubles during those moon tides. And, you know, the water's going to move in and out in the same time period, but it's just twice as quick and twice as fast. And a lot of the bait fish can't handle it. And that's when you'll see the blitzes happen right out in front of these creeks where they meet the ocean. They'll just get crushed.
I'd be happy just seeing that, even if I didn't have gear with me, which is not going to happen. I've never seen a big blitz of bait fish before. Like, I saw a couple small ones on the Chesapeake, but nothing what I read about and seen photos of up in New England.
I mean, unfortunately, July and August isn't going to be the best time to maybe see a blitz, just because of how hot it gets during the day. The blitzes will happen, but they'll be during the dark. You know, they'll be at night or really early in the morning, maybe just before sundown. That's going to be your best chance to see one. Fish kind of move offshore during the day period now.
What is the seasonality? Can you guys fish all winter? I know so last winter parts of the ocean froze solid up there.
But there are holdover fish, believe it or not, in select locations on Cape Cod, in Connecticut. They definitely have a huge holdover, you know, population going out, especially the Housatonic. This guy's guiding there all winter for holdover bass. So it seems like every year we're seeing more and more holdover fish, or the fish moving, you know, farther and farther north, starting to hold over. So yeah, you can target them during the winter months, but it's going to be all small fish.
You're watching the Patriots play anyway, right? On the weekends?
Yeah. I'm a Giants fan, so.
There we go.
Yeah. But anyway, yeah, they're going to be sluggish during the winter. I mean, if you want to wet a line, it's worth giving it a shot. But during the winter here on the Cape, actually, the trout fishing is unbelievable, and that's kind of what I do all winter long.
So are they native brook trout that are there?
Yes. So there's native, actually, sea-run brook trout that are here. And if there's a sea-run brook trout coalition, and a lot of the TU chapters around here do a lot of restoration on a few select streams, on Cape Cod, that have this native population of brook trout that goes out to the ocean and comes back, which is pretty fascinating. The state actually does a great job of stocking all the kettle ponds, which are unique to Cape Cod, with trout in the fall and in the spring. The kettle ponds are basically, when the last glacier receded, there was big chunks of ice left over. It took them a long time to melt, so they were left with these big, you know, 90 to 100-foot indentation, basically just holes all over the Cape. I think there's over 1,000 of them. And so being that deep, the water stays cold all summer long. The trout hold over. You can run into some 5-6 pound brown trout. Come up during the winter in the mornings. And, yeah, it's a great fishery.
And you said kettle holes?
Yep, kettle. Like the pot, because that's what they're shaped like. They're all pretty much wadeable, too, around the whole edge of the pond. You know, you just get in the water and make a big circle. Just, you know, a lot of English-style trout fishing techniques where, you know, full sinking lines and, people will throw, woolly buggers. They usually do well when the fish are first thrown in. A lot of times you'll be throwing like a breakaway indicator rig, 12, 13 feet down, chironomids, things like that have been working really well.
For such a salty place, that sounds fascinating.
Yeah. There really is a lot of fishing around here.
Do I need a Salt Life sticker on my car to be hanging out up there and fishing?
No. Bear's Den sticker would be nice, but Salt Life? You'll be fine.
I see people in the Midwest have Salt Life on their cars, and I'm just like, is that because the roads when it snows, or are you just a transplant from the coast?
Yeah, just, you got me.
Yeah, I don't know. All right, so you mentioned more holdover fish. Has there historically been a downfall of the populations? Like we had down here in the Chesapeake Bay, there was a moratorium in the 80s. Because they were just all fished out and the water quality was terrible. Anything like that up there?
When I was a kid, I'm 37 now. Growing up, I don't remember catching striped bass at all. It was basically you go out to the beach, hope the bluefish come in close enough. And if they do, then you're going to catch fish. But, yeah, they were definitely far and few between. I think after the moratorium, things really picked up. And, you know, that's kind of the love-hate relationship with the Cape Cod Canal. That big, huge biomass of fish goes through there. And it does get so many people. And on a good day, you'll see a lot of, you know, 30 to 50-pound fish dragged up on the rocks, taken. And, you know, that's our breeding class of fish. Yeah. You know, the breeders are gone. You know, it won't be long before we have another crash. But, I mean, most people follow the regulations and take one fish. I mean, if it was up to me, I'd say, you know, keep a 28 to 30-inch fish. You know, it's going to taste better, and, you know, you keep the breeders in there. But, I mean, they're entitled to it, and they pay for their license. So, I mean, it's almost one of those things, and until it happens, you know, unfortunately, nobody cares enough.
And having that canal, do the fish, so they're taking a shortcut. Are they less spread out around the Cape, or did other fish just fill that niche?
No, the smaller fish are more spread out around the Cape. For whatever reason, the bigger fish, from what I can see, kind of flock to the canal, and they'll flock to the area in between Martha's Vineyard and Cape Cod. They kind of call it like middle ground area. There's a huge group of, you know, big fish out there, but you need a boat to get out there. That's, you know, a lot of fishing squid patterns and, you know, big bait fish patterns in the rips out there off a boat. With the canal, I think it's the bait fish that bring the big fish in. You'll see schools of, you know, 2,000 or 3,000 mackerel swim right by your feet in the canal. Huge schools of squid go through the canal. Some nights you'll see them jumping out of the water. There's just so many of them.
Are they getting sucked through with the tide, or are they exploring that themselves?
I think they're probably exploring it themselves. I can't really see them getting sucked through. I mean, it's the openings in the, you know, the in and the out of the canal is not very wide. So it's kind of like they almost have to, you know, want to go through it. They're not going to get sucked out from the, I mean, it's a strong current, but I don't think it's going to suck bait fish through from one side to the other.
Okay. Now with this increase of fish, is that why there's more seals now? And then there's apparently more sharks?
I don't know if that's why there's more seals. I know historically, you know, seals were hunted and they're not anymore. I don't know if it's the population getting back to what it would naturally be, but I know if you go down in the Chatham area, Monomoy Island, Morris Island. If you take like a cruise to Monomoy Island, it's loaded with seals. And you can see them from Google Earth. Yeah, I mean, you zoom in on that island, beach is just seals. Yeah.
Did they ever steal fish?
I haven't really heard of anybody getting a fish stolen by a seal, like off their line. I know they definitely eat striped bass. They're definitely bringing the sharks in, though. It's kind of hard to say if they really, you know, steal fish. But they're doing a number on the, you know, on the fish. They have to eat their weight in fish, from what I understand, every day. Fortunately, there's a lot of, you know, bait fish around and a lot of scup and black sea bass and things like that for them to eat as well. So, you know, whether it's they're eating just stripers, I don't think so. But, you know, it's something you could see with the increase in seals becoming a problem in the future if the population of stripers, you know, starts to decline.
All right. Also, do you mind that this is not really about, like, blues? I'm more interested in the stripers.
No,
does that make me, like, a striper snob or something? I just don't want to deal with the teeth and the damage.
Yeah, no, I don't blame you. People have lost fingers of bluefish. They are a great fighting fish, though. I mean, for their size, out of fish I've caught, probably the best fighting fish out of them all.
If I tail one?
They're just mean.
Is it going to, like, reach around and bite me?
I don't think so. I would just have a pair of those plastic lippers on you, though.
Okay.
You know, you get that in their mouth, and you'll get the hook out, no problem. I think that's a good thing to have around, I think, in general. Especially, you know, you catch a really big striper. It's going to help with that as well.
What are they called? Are they in your shop? You said plastic lippers?
Yeah, they kind of look like a pair of vice grips. That are made out of plastic, and you go along the inside the bottom jaw, and you kind of lock it down, and it just makes handling the fish, you know, that much easier. You don't have to take the fish out of the water. You can, you know, get a hold of them by that, and inside the water, the mouths can be slippery, especially the older fish. You know, they don't really have that rough patch along the bottom lip.
It's like my dog's losing his teeth. He's old. The old fish, they get their teeth worn down, huh?
Yeah, I guess it depends what they're eating, too. I mean, the ones that are grinding down crabs and lobsters and, you know, a lot of crustaceans, it happens more so than the ones that are, I guess, feasting on squid and mackerel and things like that. They're pretty opportunistic
fish. That's pretty cool. I learned as a kid that if elephants wear down their teeth, they'll starve. They can't chew anything. After a certain age, they just all that chewing for 60 years, their teeth are polished, and they can't eat anymore, and they'll starve to death. It's old striped basket, their gums all worn down.
Yeah, I don't think they really need them, though. You just see what they can swallow.
Yeah. All right, so you mentioned Google Earth earlier. What should I be looking for? I'm doing DIY. I'm not hiring a guide. So am I looking for, you said, where the mouths, so the creek mouths come out into the beaches? Should I be looking at that? And do I just that one looks fishy? What should I be looking for to fish on, say, like Monday morning when I'm there?
Well, this time of year, I would definitely say the beaches on the north side of the Cape are going to, you know, produce better than the ones on the south. So, like, beaches in Sandwich and Barnstable and that area are probably going to do a little, you know, Brewster area are going to do a little bit better than the ones down in Falmouth and, you know, Woods Hole area, just because of the water temperature. But, yeah, looking at Google Earth, I would try to find the biggest estuaries and bays that you can find on there and then look for where that inlet empties out. You know, the bigger the estuary, the bay, the more bait fish are going to be in there, the more water is going to swing in and out of there, and that's what's going to draw the stripers close to shore.
Right on. Do I need a switch rod if I have one? Or overhand casting, I should be all right?
It's becoming more and more popular. We see that a lot in the shop. Guys, you know, want to save their shoulders, or they're getting older, or just for the ease of it, kind of generate the same line speed as you would with a double haul without having to actually, you know, perfect that double haul.
All right, I'll pack that too. We'll get some of the packing list in a moment.
Yeah, I mean, the one thing I like about the switch rod is it's going to allow you to throw, you know, 450 to 500 grains, which is really going to help in the wind.
Okay.
And it's going to help turn over the bigger flies.
Right on. Do you have certain beaches that if someone comes into the shop and they're like, hey, I'm going striper fishing, we're, you know, we have the five local trout streams and the two rivers for smallmouth here. Is there a typical place that most people fish that we should avoid while we're there? Like, does someone come into your store and they're like, I just want the place that's the easiest parking to walk into that is usually predictable to catch fish? Are there places like that?
There are. The good thing about Cape Cod is it's pretty much a spot to fish no matter where you know what your destination is or where you're gonna stay. Like I said, there are those inlets and bays all over the Cape. During the summer, the only thing you're gonna run into is parking problems during the day. If you're there early morning before the beach is open, you'll be fine. You can park in any of those lots. Once the beach is closed, usually around 5 or 6, you're not gonna have any problem parking in, you know, in any of those lots as well. There's not too many, you know, fishing only beaches. Most of the beaches around here are going to be, you know, loaded with sunbathers during the day. That's kind of why we, you know, myself and, you know, a lot of people I fish with will stick to those kind of, you know, inlets and outlets and, you know, places you have to walk. Maybe you have to walk a mile down the beach to get to the inlet, or, you know, you got to walk a half a mile. That's going to keep the bathers away. It's going to keep the spin fishermen away. You know, a lot of those places are kind of the best places you can find to fish. So, I mean, yeah, there's not really a certain place where we send people. You know, they give us a town they're staying in, and we'll do our best to hook them up with a beach. It's not too many secret spots, you know, around Cape Cod where,
imagine,
you know, it's kind of, especially with Google Earth now, you can pretty much, you know, see what's going on everywhere. And, you know, you can zoom down in the street, see if there's a beachway there. And like I said, with the law of, you know, being able to just walk on any beach, as long as you're below the high water line, it's basically just getting on the beach. People even get dropped off, just, you know, walk through.
I might just Uber.
Yeah, that'd be a great way to do it.
Are there any nude beaches I have to watch out for? All of a sudden, like, my back cast might get hooked on something. I have stumbled across nude beaches before.
Not that I'm aware of. I'm sure there's a couple scattered throughout, but I honestly wouldn't know where they were.
Okay. You're not one of them.
No.
Okay. All right, so a packing list. What should I pack with me. I've got a sort of a list of things here. If you want to go through basic gear list for someone coming to the Cape, like what rod, reel, outfit should they have or is suggested?
I mean, we suggest a 9-weight rod. Ideally, maybe if you have an 8 and a 10-weight, bring that. 10-weight's going to help you if the wind picks up, if you want to throw huge flies. 8-weight would be great for a calm day, you know, smaller flies. 9-weight's kind of right in the middle. That's kind of where we steer most people because they'll do a little bit of everything. Intermediate sink lines, 95% of the time, that's what I'm fishing, you know, just to get you below the wave crest. You know, so you don't have any slack in your line when you come tight to a fish. If you're going to have a second line, I would say a fast sink tip, you know, like a 350 to 400 grain sink tip just to get you down in some of the deeper channels or the inlets and outlets when the water's really, you know, whipping through. As far as reels go, you don't necessarily need a large arbor reel. It can help, but the stripers don't really, you know, do a huge run. They're not going to run at you. They're going to bulldog you, so you need a strong drag. If you have a big fish on, you're probably going to V-max and you drag, you know, pretty much close to full power to slow them down and, you know, get them under control. Leader-wise, if you're fishing, you know, just estuaries, bays, probably 16-pound to 20-pound leaders will be fine. If you're going to try to get them on the flats, which is kind of a whole other ball game, they can be shy. I'd probably stay 12 to 16 pound leaders for that.
Flats. What would be non-flats fishing? That would be the bays and estuaries?
Bays, estuaries, open beaches. Flats is basically, you know, just what it sounds like. There's spots where, you know, you'll have a whole kind of mile long area of just 2 feet deep water. And stripers are kind of cruising that, trying to get out to the channel, and you kind of intercept them on the way back.
And that's the famous Monomoy flats that I've always read and heard about and seen in photographs and everything else.
Monomoy's got them. Brewster's got them. Yeah, Barnstable Harbor's got them. It's actually quite a lot of flats around the Cape. And, you know, it's a sight fishing game. And having a boat there definitely helps. You can wander the flats on foot for miles and, you know, not see a fish. You know, if you have a boat, it makes things a lot easier. And even then, like, I was out early this year. You know, you see schools of 30, 40 big fish swimming by, and they don't want anything to do with the fly.
Ah, all right. Well, I'm going to try it regardless if there's fish in there because I just have to experience that.
Yeah, it's a beautiful area.
All right. Other things. Stripping basket. I have one. I haven't used it in probably 15 years.
I'd definitely bring it.
All right. What kind of shoes? I just bought the Orvis Andros flats boots.
Yeah, those should be fine. I mean, if you're going to try to fish the canal, you're definitely going to want studded rubber spikes.
How far is that from Chatham if I'm going to drive?
It's quite a ways, actually. Probably almost an hour. Huh. Yeah.
Yeah, so there's going to be like seven or eight of, or nine of us in one house. So I don't think I'll get the car for that long.
Yeah, I mean, it's something you can stop, like, on the way down or on the way back. Just you're going to drive over it, so you can, you know, get out there and take a look at it. But, yeah, usually, you know, those flats hikers should be fine for the most part. If you're going to just stay on the beaches, you know, in shallow areas, they'll be great. It can get rocky in, you know, some spots where you'll see inlets and outlets. But for the most part, those shoes should be fine.
All right, and you're wearing waders in your recent Instagram pictures. Is that for comfort or because of studs on the bottom?
I almost always wear waders. I'm not really sure why. It's kind of something I've always done around the Cape. I'm usually out in the middle of the night, you know, really early morning. The water can be a little bit cooler, and I'm usually out there, you know, for 3, 4, 5 hours at a time. It's basically just to stay dry and you know, comfortable.
I like that. Sunglasses, preference for color up there for the lenses?
I mean, out on the open water, if you're on a boat, I'd say, you know, maybe blue mirror, green mirror, something like that. But I'm actually always wearing the new sunrise glasses from Costa. I like them.
Yeah, I just sent my lenses in to get the glass ones put in the sunrise mirror.
Yeah,
I wish I'd done it before this trip, so I could use it.
But yeah, just about anything that's polarized, polarization definitely is. As long as you have that, you should be pretty good.
How's the sun this time of year?
Middle of the day can definitely be strong. So, yeah, if you're going to be on those, Chatham area from, 12 to 3 o'clock, you're definitely going to need the sunscreen.
I just got those Sims arm sleeves.
I'm kind of excited to try those out.
So I can wear a t-shirt that flaps in the wind a little bit, get some airflow. Yep. All right. What about the ladders I always heard about for the flats up there?
I've seen a couple guys, carrying them around. It seems like an awful lot of work for me anyway. The flats are pretty expansive, and to carry a ladder around you all day out there.
Just schlep it from spot to spot is not going to be fun.
Yeah, it just seems a bit much. I mean, from the Monomoy area, from the the most popular parking area out to the channel, you're looking at almost a mile walk as it is. To schlep a ladder that whole way.
Yeah, and, unless you wrap it in pool noodles and just it flows maybe.
Yeah, I don't know. I saw a guy have one built into a backpack earlier this month. It was kind of cool, but again, if it's that much work, I'm probably fishing somewhere else.
His superpowers. I'm ladder man. I can help cats stuck in trees. I can wade the flats. I'm ladder man. I got my headlamp packed for early morning and late night.
Yep, definitely need one of those.
Okay. Now, see, so locating fish, we're looking for the rips. What about along jetties? Like in that little corner spot? Are they going
to? Sometimes. I mean, I haven't found a whole huge, massive stripers along jetties. Like, I know in Rhode Island, a lot of it's, jetty fishing, and, that's where people, kind of flock to. But there's just, it seems like there's more open beaches on the Cape, and to fish off the jetties, it's not really effective with the fly rod. Especially like the huge long jetties, like the one down at Woods Hole, things like that. It'd be a lot of spin fishermen there, and it's just more effective to fish the other side of the inlet, or not off the rocks, where the inlet starts from shore. Swinging a fly through there. We don't have to worry about tangling with, 20 other guys.
And then with these beaches, I'm just going to kind of camp out for the day, like leave my backpack down beside me, like 30 feet away, and just walk to the water?
Yeah, definitely.
Oh, this is going to be nice. It's going to be the opposite of my steelhead fishing in winter, where I'm just cold, wet, and miserable, and camped down in one spot all day.
Yeah, no, it's definitely a walking game. It seems like, the more and farther you walk, the better the chance of you hooking up is, too.
And approaching these fish, if I see them just appear out on the beach, I've done a little bit of flats fishing, stocking carp. Is it the same thing? Just cast in front of them, hope where they're going, they'll pick up on it?
Yeah, and they're going to be extremely spooky if you see them out, on the beach. And I think that just stems from, when they were younger fish with all, there's a ton of avian predators around and, seals around. And, I don't think, even though they're big fish, I don't think they realize, that the birds aren't a threat to them anymore. So they're very wary of pretty much everything. You put a line over the top of them, they're going to be gone. So,
right. And then the ones definitely that are at the mouth of the estuaries, they're going to be, so that's with the sinking line. They're going to be down deep too.
They'll be down a little bit deeper. You can definitely use your intermediate line. They'll come up for the fly. But, as long as there's a lot of moving water over their head and, if you can't see them, they're going to be a lot easier to catch than the ones that you can see.
Do I need to wear blend into the sky and beach kind of clothes?
I wouldn't bother. All right. I haven't seen them be that crazy.
All right. So I want to talk about flies now. That was my question. Anything else about approaching the fish I should know?
Not really. I mean, if you do see them on the beach, just, like you said, it's like flats fishing anywhere else. You just got to be, very wary for a fish that's so aggressive and seems to hit anything, in a rip or in an estuary situation. You get them on the flats, they turn into a whole different fish.
Interesting. Very cool. Okay. Let's talk about what they're eating up there. It's pretty much sand eels and small bait fish. I know there's some crab patterns.
I mean, depending on the time of year you come. If you were to come early in the season, you know, very end of April, beginning, you know, month of May, they would have probably been on, you know, herring patterns. And that kind of changes as the season progresses. It goes from herring to, you'll see like the first schools of pretty large bunker come in, you know, Menhaden, and then the squid will come in with them. After that, you're going to see a lot of, you know, anchovies and silver sides will kind of make their way in with the mackerel. This time of year, you're starting to see more and more, you know, sand eels. They kind of stay around through the fall. And in the beginning of the fall, that's when you'll see those, you know, those peanut bunker blitzes with them getting flung up on the beach, you know, and then the herring leave and the squid leave again in the late fall. So you'll, you know, kind of go back to those. But as far as patterns go, they're always hitting clousers and deceivers. And then there's kind of like this northern New England, you know, school of flies that originated, I guess, in Rhode Island with the Rhodey fly rotters. Guy by the name of Kenny Abrams and Ray Bondereau. Kenny Abrams has a book out called The Perfect Fish. That's kind of the book that popularized all the flat wings and these hair wing flies that everybody's, you know, using now. We have a number of local fly tires. Tie for the shop, flat wings. Steve Cook and Joe Cadero, probably, you know, two of the best flat wing tires around. The raised fly is always popular. That's named after Ray Bondereau. It's basically just a hair wing fly. You have, you know, a hook with some body braid on it, some white bucktail, yellow bucktail, olive bucktail, and peacock on top. You know, flies like that just seem to crush it all year. Just those, you know, bucktail style flies. Then out in Martha's Vineyard, you know, you have Dave Skok and Jamie Boyle out there. Dave Skok came up with the mushmouth fly. That always kills. You know, Jamie Boyle has a red can squid. That's a great squid fly that always seems to work in the rips. You know, and, you know, crab patterns are always working. Bob Popovic, you know, influence flies are always working. You know, surf candies and, you know, his hollow flies have been producing a lot lately. Yeah, just like those classic kind of flies. Really gets it done.
How important is to match the hatch, or are they more opportunistic? If they're feeding on, you throw an anchovies at them, but they're only eating sand eels. Are they gonna notice?
Seems like the smaller the fish, the less it matters.
What's a small
fish? There's a ton of, I'd say small fish is gonna be, you know, 14 to 18 inches long. Fish like that, you can pretty much put anything in front of them, and they're just gonna. They're going to go for it. You know, the medium-sized fish, you know, I'd say like 18 inches up to keeper size, those are the ones that are going to be really, you know, picky as far as matching the hatch. And this time of year, the sand eels really do start to come around. They haven't really...
Exactly. I know garden eels. My brother used to do scuba diving research in the Mediterranean and Polynesia with these giant things that would sit like a question mark with their tails in a hole in the sand. That's what I think of sand eels. These are completely different looking.
The ones we see mostly are between, I'd say, 4 and 7 inches long. And it's just, you know, they're thin, like almost like a Bic pen kind of thinness. You know, white on the bottom, olive to black on top. And, you know, when they're eating those, it's hard to get them to look at other things. I don't know if it's because they're so focused on finding them or, you know, who knows, you know, what goes through their head. Yeah, but they, you know, once the sand eels come in heavy, you definitely want to be throwing sand eel patterns. But they haven't really come in heavy yet.
They spend some time in the sand? They live in the sand?
Yeah, I mean, I've seen them in the sand. I don't know if that's where they get the name from. But, yeah, you definitely see them down in the sand sometimes.
Do they live in shallow water? Where do you see them? The deep water? The flats?
No, you'll see them all around your feet. And, you know, and it's funny. When you wade the estuaries and the mouths of these creeks and, you know, even inside the bays, you always wind up with a cloud of baitfish, you know, seeking refuge behind you. You know, it's almost like, you know, they feel safe. You know, swimming next to you, and then, yeah, they'll just flock to you. you'll know what the bait is pretty quick.
All right, I'm going to take an aquarium net with me then. I want to catch these things.
Yeah, definitely. If you fish at night, you shine a light in the water, the fish will just jump out of the water, all over the place. You'll know there's bait there real quick.
Speaking of night fishing, are there places with lights where they congregate around? We're used to that on the Chesapeake Bay. You find a dock with a bright light.
Not so much. I'm sure there are places. That's one place that's kind of frowned upon. Fishing around the Cape was going to be like inside the actual boat harbors where the bright lights will be around the boats. They really don't let you fish off the docks, in between the boats like they do in, some other places that I've visited. It's mostly the same, inlets and outlets and, the same spots you're going to fish during the day in the spring is where you're going to fish at night, during the summer. It just, it brings the bait fish in and then the big fish follow.
How important is the fly size? I've been tying up one of the guys at the Jersey show that I've known for years. I told him I was going to Cape Cod and he's like, I'll be right back. And he brought me this fly. And it looks like the one I just Googled Cape Cod Clouser. And that fly came up. And he's like, it's got to be the size. We talked about this on the Drew Chacone podcast. It's got to be the size of his index finger from his thumb to his fingertip. And I said, well, that's great for your hand, but my hand's different. So if my hands are different, if mine is big, my hand's bigger and my fly's bigger, is that going to affect it if it's a centimeter off?
No, I mean, and I wouldn't really, I would take that with, I kind of take that with a grain of salt. If you told me you were going to be fishing in the Cape Cod Canal, going for huge fish, you're going to need flies that are almost a foot long. That's kind of what we're throwing there. You kind of match the size of your fly to the fish, that you're expecting to catch. It's not that I haven't caught big fish on small flies, but, if you're really targeting the huge fish, you're going to want a nice, big, either hollow fly or like a Steve Farrar blend mackerel size fly or even like a big squid. But, regular size clouser deceivers, 3 to 4 inches long, you'll be fine. If I was going to tie mushmouths, I'd do them the same. The same size. The flat wing flies that I tie up, probably a little bit bigger, maybe 5 to 6 inches long, depending on the feathers I can find for those. But yeah, they hit them all. So I don't think size is a huge deal. The only time I've ever seen that come into play is when they're on glass minnows. That can get really frustrating. They'll be like these little 1.5 to 2 inch size fish. They're almost clear. They don't bite anything else except these little tiny flies.
I'm not even going to bother tying them. But what size hook should I be tying my clousers and sand eels on?
Anywhere from 2 to 2-aught. I think you're good.
Okay, I got to get bigger hooks. I'm tying them on size 1s. I'm not planning on anything bigger than like 20 size, inches.
Yes, size 1 should be fine. Okay. Like I said, as long as you're size 2 or, 2 to right up through 2-aught, you'll be fine with clousers and deceivers and sand eels.
Your small stripers are what we would consider big on the fly around here. Small for us is 6 inches long on an 8-weight. We get those all the time.
We hardly see any of those around.
Yeah.
Pretty much.
More little ones. All right, what about dumbbell size for the clousers? I'm using large.
Yeah, medium, large. You can vary it. I throw clousers every once in a while, kind of when I'm not catching them or anything else, because for some reason, that jigging action seems to set them off when nothing else will. But when I'm tying them, that's when I'm tying medium and large. And we kind of steer people away from fishing them if they don't have much experience, just because of, how they can have a tendency to break rods. But, if somebody like yourself who knows what they're doing, I'd stay medium to large. Almost the bigger the better as far as the clouser is going to go, because that's the fly that you're going to fish that's going to get you down near the bottom.
Okay. Do you have a hook brand preference when you're tying your own flies? Do you tie your own?
Yeah, I do. Awesome. I tie some for the shop as well. It really depends on the fly. I mean, there's so many good hooks out there, but clousers and deceivers and things like that, I'm pretty much using just the 34 007s. Flat wings, I kind of go, the just because that's what all the older guys I've learned from, the Eagle Claw L252s and 3s, that's what I'll tie the flatwings on. But any of the really big flies that I'm tying, like squid and mackerel, I'm using the 12S, the Gamagatsus. Okay. So kind of go all over the place.
If I'm going to bring a mobile fly tying kit, what would I bring with me? I think I'm just looking at tying sand eels and clousers now. So just like bucktails and saddle hackles. We already talked hooks, dumbbells.
Yeah, I mean, if you wanted to keep it simple, you could definitely catch fish with just bucktail, hooks, and thread.
Right on. I also have the super clouser material for my sand eels.
Super hair works great. I know Dave Skoke ties a lot of his clousers with that, and they definitely crush the fish.
Do you have a preference for any UV resins or coatings for the sand eels? Or like the Bob Popovic style?
Yeah, I mean, working at the shop, I've kind of had a chance to dabble in all of them. And to be honest with you, when it first came out, it was lacking a little bit, I think, as far as the tackiness of the finished product was. But now they seem to all work really well. Definitely cut the time down on making a fly. The one thing I do with all of them is I still go over the top of them with either hardest hull or hardest nails type coating, just to get that super clear, clean finish to them.
Right.
So I still think they all have a little tack to them once once they're set.
Particular colors of bucktail material and feathers?
Olive and white. Chartreuse and white, all white. At night, a lot of people go with black and purple. I used to switch to dark flies at night. Lately, I've just been throwing the chartreuse flies that I have on, and I've been doing pretty much just as well. So I don't really carry two sets of flies around with me anymore.
With all these questions, somehow I have in my mind that your striped bass are completely different and more educated than the ones we have in the mid-Atlantic, even though they're probably the same fish at different times of year. Somehow I think they're going to outsmart me with my flies. I'm asking all these color and size questions, even though down here the same stuff.
I mean, I really think the biggest thing is just getting in front of fish. If you can get in front of, schooling size fish, anything from, 14 inches up to 28 inches, you're going to catch them. It's really just a matter of finding them, being at the right spot at the right tide. Very rarely do we, run into fish that are, that are refusing flies, unless they're on the flats, like I mentioned before. I take the Wednesday night group out, and the nights, we're catching fish. Everybody's using different flies. Some nights we're out there, we catch 40 fish. Other nights we go out there, maybe one guy will catch a fish, maybe two guys will catch a fish. But like I said, everybody's throwing different stuff and they're biting all of it. So it's really a matter of, just being there when it's happening.
What about dropper flies? Is that legal? Is it needed?
It's legal. I know some guys who will swing two flat wings through, to me, it just seems like one more thing that can get screwed up, especially at night where, I can't see my cast a lot of times. I'm just fishing the single fly.
All right, we talked tides, moons. That's about it. What about precipitation? If it's pouring rain, they're still biting. Are they more likely to bite up there in the rain?
With the striped bass, I've kind of found it to shut it down a little bit if it's pouring rain. Right before it rains, though, can be excellent. A couple hours before a storm, even a day before a storm, it seems like they know, something's about to go on, and it just gets everything moving. A couple weeks ago, we had a pretty good, pretty good patch of rough weather rolling in, and the day or two before, the fishing was just incredible.
What about someone going on vacation that doesn't have the leisure of picking when they're going to fish? Is there a bad time of day for somebody on vacation, or just fish as often as you can when you can?
I mean, this time of year, if you're targeting striped bass, I'd say if you're going to, you know, a time of day that you're not going to want to be out there, if you had to pick one, would be the middle of the day. You'd be better off, you know, sleeping in the middle of the day, staying up all night and, you know, fishing at night, if that's just what, you know, you want to do to catch fish. There's fish out during the day. I mean, there's scup and sea bass and fluke and sea robins, and, you know, you can spend all day, you know, trying to catch those things.
I don't like the sea robins. They're kind of creepy.
Yeah, and there's a lot of them around now, too. Oh,
they're so weird looking.
But, yeah, that's, you know, July and August, it's those are the 2 months where the fishing during the day seems to slow down. You know, September and October, you get the albies come in. You know, so during the day, you know, you can, it's incredible fishing if you can get in front of a school of albies. But, yeah, this time of year, I would say stick to at night, you know, early morning, right before sunrise, you know, and then the sunset time period. It's really just that middle of the day period. It's going to be tough. If you have a boat, you can get out there, you know, and fish the rips, and, you know, you catch fish during the day. But from shore, July and August is tough.
All right. Do I have to worry about being caught anywhere when the tide comes in?
A lot of the flats fishing, it can be deceiving. I know you said you're going to, you know, the Monomoy Morris Island area. Yeah, that flat can fill up behind you. I would just be careful, especially with the, you know, with the full moon coming up. You're gonna have more water moving in and out than normal. So that flat's gonna look, you know, there's gonna be more sand exposed than usual. So you'll be able to walk out farther than usual. And I would say the same would go for like the Brewster flats. You know, anywhere you have a big expanse flat, you know, the water can fill in behind you. Really, what can get dangerous is if you're out there in the fog. I've been out there a couple times where, you know, it's crystal clear when you go out, you know, right around sunset, all of a sudden the fog rolls in, you know, you spin around a couple times and you really can't tell which way the beach is. It's a good idea to just carry a compass with you.
What about
if there's any,
don't get compass. That's another one for the list. What about, smartphone coverage out there?
Yeah, I haven't had an issue all over the whole Cape. You should be fine.
Maybe I'll update my phone to have a compass app, too, besides Google Maps. Anything else fishing related? I didn't ask before I get into some of the travel questions. What about, like, bizarre fish? What would you catch and just be like, that's the strangest thing, I never thought I'd catch one? You had any of those moments?
Last couple of years, we've got into northern kingfish. We found them on the flats. Probably getting six or seven of them. They kind of, you know, they're, I don't know if you have them where you are, but they're almost shaped like a bonefish. They have the downturned mouth, almost have like an army camo kind of, you know, olive and dark green pattern to them. They run, not like a bonefish runs, but, you know, they run pretty good for their size around here. And they're kind of, you know, digging up crabs and shrimp and things like that. So, yeah, it's a pretty cool fish to catch. You know, every once in a while you hear somebody catch something ridiculous in the canal. They caught a sailfish there a couple years ago. Yeah, you fish it. I mean, it's not really a big fly fishing place, but if you're out in the canal enough, you see some crazy things. You see, you know, pods of dolphins go through there. They see whales go through there.
My goodness.
You never know what you're going
to
see.
Someone needs to put a GoPro in there, a couple of them, because it's so big. All right, so what about, where should I be eating? You got like a good breakfast joint if you're going to be out early that serves early breakfast?
Breakfast joint. Not a big breakfast person. I'm kind of a Dunkin' and Go kind of guy. I do like to sit down and have a nice, you know, lunch or dinner, though.
What are some spots you recommend?
Well, in Falmouth, there's quite a few restaurants. There's one called Añejo. It's kind of a Mexican restaurant, but an authentic Mexican food. It's fantastic. Yeah, there's the dining. I mean, it's kind of hard to say one over another. There's a ton of dining opportunities all throughout the Cape.
My wife wants to eat so much lobster that she's tired of eating lobster before she goes home.
That's gonna be possible. Oh yeah, there'll be lobster stands, lobster roll stands. You know, they'll be all over the place. I'm sure you could find a place to eat a lobster every couple of miles if you really wanted to.
As a non-seafood guy, am I going to be intrigued by some of the things up there? They got stuff for the landlubbers?
Yeah, it's a great mix. You pretty much have everything up here. You know, and it being, tourist season driven, if the food's not good, the place isn't going to survive. So, you know, a lot of the – you're kind of left with a lot of good food in a small area.
Right. What about hush puppies? Is that a thing up there?
Not really.
Damn. That's what I was looking forward to. Any local foods up there that I've never heard of? Like, they'd be like, oh, yeah, we all eat them in this sort of area. But no one outside of that neighborhood or that part of the Cape would ever know of. Like, what would Andrew Zimmern be there eating that he would never have before?
It's a good question. I haven't really run into that much on the Cape, to be honest with you. That's more of a Rhode Island thing. You know, there's a lot of, as a foodie, someday take a trip through Rhode Island and you'll see a lot of food you won't find anywhere. Seafood, they have like a lot of clam cake shacks down there, which really isn't a cake at all, like a crab cake. It's more of like a clam fritter, kind of fried poof ball of, golden goodness. Dell's lemonade, coffee milk. It's a lot of local, a lot of crazy local food in Rhode Island. Not so much.
Is it Frank Pepe's? Don Pepe? The tomato pie guy in Hartford.
Yeah.
We're going to try and stop there. What about places to avoid? Are there just absolute tourist trap neighborhoods where it's all t-shirt vendors and tchotchkes?
Not so much. I mean, there's times to avoid the coming on and off the Cape. Friday night is probably going to be the worst time to try to get on the Cape. There's really only, two ways to get on and off the Cape. It's either can be the Sagamore Bridge or the Bourne Bridge. And at the end of each bridge, there's a rotary. Every car that goes on that, through that rotary is going to go on the bridge. So you can imagine how far that gets backed up during a busy season. Friday nights and Sunday late morning to early afternoon, probably only two times you're really going to run into a huge traffic problem on the Cape. The rest of the time, it's especially during the week, it's pretty much spread out. For a tourist area, it's pretty big. There's not really a spot that everybody just flocks to.
And has the brewery scene hit there yet? Are there little micro brews popping up where you can go do a little day drinking with the family, do some sampling?
There's quite a lot of definitely a lot of pubs, pub food opportunities. Not so many, micro brews on the Cape. Massachusetts has quite a few in the western part of the state. I know, like Treehouse is an excellent one. Down on the Cape, not so much. It's not a huge microbrew scene like you'd find in like Burlington, Vermont or something like that.
The amount of breweries that open in industrial parks around Northern Virginia is just gone insane. You can go anywhere and just within 5 miles, you can probably hit up three places now.
Wow.
It's crazy here. You don't even know what to buy at some of the beer stores. It's just such a variety. There used to be one brewery here, Dominion, and that was it.
I mean, you'll definitely have a good variety of stuff to buy. You're not going to be able to stop into brewery after brewery like you can in some other spots.
Any beers up there that I can't get down here? Those Western Massachusetts ones? Treehouse?
Yeah, that's the guy at the beer shop. Treehouse is great if you can find it. It's one of my favorites. I know you can get it everywhere, but if you're in Mass, you kind of got to have a Sam Adams.
Indeed. Got to go with the historical beer up there. Let's see. Where should I pick up a license? At the shop?
Online? Yeah, it's definitely the easiest way to do it. The shop doesn't sell licenses. Not too many shops do, actually. It's a simple, not even 5-minute process online to pick it up. And that license, if you buy it through Massachusetts, will be good in Rhode Island and New Hampshire as well.
Interesting. What about rods on shoulders? Do the kids pose with rods on shoulders with their fish up there? I have a hard time with the kids posing with the rods on their shoulders.
Not more than any other way, I'd say. Usually the fish, I know a lot of the striped bass that are, you know, photo worthy, I'd say, they're going to be too big to worry about putting the rod on your shoulder as well. So,
all right. Are there any etiquette things up there? Like down here, not fishing related, but you don't stand on the left side of an escalator in D.C. You'll get yelled at. Anything up there that you don't want to do to offend somebody on the water, on the beach? Any local traditions you should be knowledgeable of?
Just give people their space fishing-wise. You know, there's so much beach around. You see people hooking up, don't go run right over to them and, you know, start casting right next to them. You know, culture-wise, there's so many rotaries on the Cape. I would say just make sure you yield at them all. Or are you going to, you know, you're going to wind up in some trouble.
Rotary as in like a traffic circle?
Yeah, traffic circle. Okay. Yeah, it's, there's a ton of them.
They put one in on the way to my parents' house, and it pisses me off. One lane in each direction, and they put in a traffic circle. I don't get it.
Yeah, they're going to drive you nuts when you're, you know, on your stay up here.
Great. My Russian father-in-law is going to have a field day with that. He got pulled over once for going too many times around the Pentagon in the 80s. Great. Anything else I forgot to ask you? Things you – that's like an FAQ for up there that we forgot to go over?
Not really. I mean, unless you wanted to talk algae fishing. I don't know if you're into that at all.
Maybe we could do a fall talk on Albies.
Yeah, definitely.
We'll schedule that. All right. If you had a superpower to make you a better angler, what would you choose?
Better angler. Talk to the fish.
There you go. All right. And favorite Harrison Ford movie?
Empire Strikes Back.
There you go. Good answer. All right, Anthony. Well, I appreciate you taking the time out, and I'm looking forward to shaking hands with you on Saturday. This Saturday.
Yeah. Anytime, Rob. Fantastic. Thanks for having me on.
Thank you. All right.
Thank you for joining us for the Fly Fishing Consultant Podcast. For more information or to contact Rob, please go to www.robsnowwhite.com.
Freestone Media.